What do you think? What share of new drugs actually provide significant therapeutic benefit compared to existing medicines? And do you think that drugs with a low clinical benefit are indeed priced any cheaper than the highly beneficial ones? You should watch this video if you want to understand the basics of drug development and the dire truth behind new drugs. I'm collecting your bets. Let me know in a comment if you already have a suspicion. To add more pessimism, we will also talk about two cancer drugs which only after their regulatory approval were shown to lead to equal or potentially even worse outcomes for patients. One of these debated drugs ultimately triggered bankruptcy of the company who developed it. But the molecule also has some nice chemistry behind it. You know the channel, we will take any opportunity to study organic synthesis that we get. Let's face the facts. Healthcare spending has exploded and grown much faster than gross domestic product in the US and everywhere else. Drug costs are one driver behind this. The most extreme example is perhaps cancer, where we can observe an almost exponential growth of drug costs over the last 50 years. The US spent $4.2 trillion on healthcare in 2021. Who paid the bill and on what? As you can see, government spending on Medicare and Medicaid is about 40%, whereas patients paid out of pocket for 10% of costs. On the receiving end, hospital care received the bulk of the spend with 31% of total, and prescription drugs coming in at 9%. So high drug costs are problematic, but as we see, they're not the only reason behind high healthcare spend. Initially expensive branded drugs become much cheaper after the entry of generic drugs. Fortunately, this leads to more accessible, vital treatment options for patients. In the past decades, this elevated the standards of care across all diseases. However, we need new medicines to continuously drive improvements in therapeutic benefit. But do they? Let's imagine we have a new drug in a disease that affects the liver, demonstrating it slows loss of liver function by 25% in whatever metric. Sounds good in theory, but let's assume this was only tested against placebo and already approved treatments have shown similar results in their trials as well. If we ignore any benefits on things like safety or durability of response, this means the relative therapeutic benefit of this therapy would be rather low. On the other hand, a new drug showing superior efficacy to other already approved treatments would be much better. Instead of me too drugs, we would want any new therapies to significantly improve on existing products. The problem is that this has not been the case in past years. The authors of the first piece of research looked at the last decade's new drug approvals and the ratings of therapeutic value provided by health technology assessment bodies in France and Germany. These agencies assess the added benefit of a drug's approved indication compared with existing therapies. This tells us whether there is a major, considerable, minor, or no benefit of a new drug. The underlying criteria are slightly different across countries but capture the drug's effect on reduction of disease duration or side effects, for example. If any of the two agencies rated the drug as providing considerable or major benefit, the authors considered it a high-value drug in their analysis. The sad result is that only 40-50% of drugs approved by the US FDA or European EMA regulator are high-value drugs. But check out the second set of bars. These refer to approved uses in additional diseases or indications that follow a drug's first approval. In these settings, they are even less likely to be quote-unquote better drugs. But why can drugs have more than one indication in the first place? As most of you know, a single mechanism of action can apply to different diseases. For instance, immuno-oncology drugs like PD-1 inhibitors can be applied across various solid tumors. Keytruda, the soon-to-be world's best-selling medicine, is approved in more than a dozen different tumor types. Beyond oncology, we have complement inhibitors like Soliris, which you might remember if you watched the previous video on the world's most expensive drugs. These anti-C5 agents are efficacious in blood disorders, but also neurological diseases and potentially organ injuries like acute kidney injury. Because the complement immune pathway is involved in many diseases, it is possible that the same drug which saves kidneys might save eyes as well. On one hand, patients benefit from this because they get more than one option, which might help them to go into disease remission, but not always. It also makes sense for pharma companies to get rewarded by bringing innovation to more patients in more diseases. As we've seen in our previous video, pharmaceutical companies invest billions in clinical development, so it makes sense from a business perspective to maximize the revenue potential of medicines during their limited window of exclusivity. This pleasant theory gets shattered once we look at the reality, with only 40% of drugs in supplementary indications bringing significant new benefit. If we look at the relative rate, drugs are less and less likely to bring new therapeutic benefit in every follow-on indication. Some caveats remain regarding this study, like questions behind the precise logic of defining something as high therapeutic benefit. There are specific local factors as well, like France using their own national therapeutic strategy as a criterion. On the flip side, we have to consider that while a drug might not be high value on average, subsegments of patients with specific mutations or other characteristics might respond very well. We know who might respond best for some drugs, and we will hear about an example in a moment, but for most diseases and medicines, this is less clear. This research confirms what others have found before. An interesting second analysis differentiated the therapeutic value of normal drugs and those with expedited approvals. This exception is awarded for drugs with major therapeutic promise in conditions with high unmet need, like certain cancers or underserved rare diseases. The logic is obvious. Imagine there's a drug which shows drastic tumor shrinkage in an early phase 2 clinical trial. Instead of waiting 3 to 4 years for larger and longer term data, an accelerated approval might be life-saving for many patients. These accelerated approvals require drug developers to run confirmatory trials in parallel, with the hope that the drug will be proven fully efficacious and safe only retrospectively. In a minute, we will talk about two cases where this unfortunately was not the case. The publication at hand also included other expedited regulatory mechanisms in their analysis, such as fast track and priority review, as well as breakthrough therapy designations. So, what do you think is the value add of these expedited programs? As you might expect and can see in the much higher purple band, drugs under these expedited mechanisms are more likely to have high therapeutic value. Most program types are in a similar range, with breakthrough designations coming in highest. 60% are indeed high value. While normal approvals are at a crappy 13%, it gets better with more and more designations. These exceptions are awarded during development, so before the clinical product profile becomes clear. Thus, it's obvious that we will never get to, let's say, 90% for breakthroughs, simply because drugs which appear very promising in phases 1 or 2 might prove out to be only mediocre after a larger scale phase 3. Still, regulatory agencies should give additional explanations or disclaimers to set more realistic expectations for patients and doctors. Finally, let's see what the 2020 study has to say, covering 65 cancer drugs across various countries. The sad insight: low-benefit drugs are just as expensive as high-benefit medicines. You can see that the blue and red distributions are awfully close to each other, with no statistically significant differences between them. From this chart, you can also immediately see why the US is the major pharma market globally, with drug costs roughly 1.5 times higher than in the European high-income countries. In summary, new drugs do not always mean innovation, breakthroughs are not always proven to be true breakthroughs, and a high price does not mean high value. Did any of these statistics surprise you? On an optimistic side, we should remember that this is just theory and does not reflect the real-world use of these drugs. For instance, patients will not switch to a new drug which works just as well or worse as what they are already on, and payers would restrict coverage for high-priced drugs with dubious efficacy. However, as we alluded to at the start, there are unfortunately cases where drugs are proven to be quote-unquote useless. Let's check out two examples and then dive into some chemistry. The first one is Avastin, which is a VEGF targeting antibody which suppresses the growth of new blood vessels. This hinders the supply of nutrients to the cancer, slowing its growth and therefore slowing cancer progression. Avastin was successfully approved in a broad set of tumors, so we can see the theme of supplemental indications mentioned in our first part. The problem really was around its accelerated approval in metastatic breast cancer, which was given in 2008. At the time, the FDA's Oncology Advisory Committee, so an outside advisory panel, had actually recommended 5-4 against approving Avastin in metastatic breast cancer. This mixed opinion was because Avastin at the time was not shown to extend patients' lives. Let's look at the details of the clinical study comparing Avastin as an add-on to chemotherapy. Overall survival, so the time from trial entry to patient death, is the gold standard primary endpoint in cancer trials, but takes more time and sample size to collect. Avastin missed the mark on this important metric. Avastin's OS is numerically higher, 26.7 months versus 25.2 months, but this is not statistically significant as indicated by a p-value of much higher than 0.05. On the flip side, progression-free survival was significantly improved. PFS is the time between treatment start and first evidence of disease progression or also death. This means that PFS data becomes available earlier than OS, so it's commonly used as a surrogate endpoint. Essentially, Avastin reduced the speed of progression by more than 5 months, but patients were ultimately not living longer. Their subjective quality of life did not increase either. You might think, okay, this is not great, but if the drug slows down progression, shouldn't it be approved nevertheless? An additional problem was the overall 20% increase in adverse events with Avastin. Toxic effects like hypertension or infections increased significantly, and this resulted in 6 deaths being directly attributed to the drug. So considering all evidence, the accelerated approval was quite optimistic but also understandable given the lack of other treatments showing similar PFS benefit. As we learned, accelerated approvals require parallel studies which intend to confirm the drug's benefit. However, the opposite happened. Looking at the later stage trial comparing 2 doses of Avastin, the extended PFS was still there. But with just under 1 month difference between trial arms, this was significantly lower than expected. More importantly, patients on Avastin had numerically shorter OS. Because of the high p-value, we can't really say if this means Avastin is indeed worse or just equal to chemotherapy. These findings led the FDA to withdraw the metastatic breast cancer indication for Avastin. Interestingly, the European EMA did not follow suit. In their view, benefits outweigh the risks given the positive, albeit small PFS benefit, and a lack of statistically significant detrimental effect on OS. Our second case study is Rucaparib, which was indicated among other uses for the third line treatment in ovarian cancer. It belongs to the class of PARP inhibitors which interfere with DNA repair mechanisms in tumor cells. Like the results for Avastin, Rucaparib was shown to extend the median PFS by 5 months. Patients with DNA repair deficient tumors responded even better as these are more prone to PARP inhibition. This seemed like a solid benefit at the time, but can you guess the problem? 4 years after its approval, now in 2022, more mature data on overall survival came in. The harsh reality, across different data cuts, patients on treatment again did not live longer. We need to check the p-value to see that even in the BRCA mutated subgroup, the potential strong responders, the seemingly beneficial effect is not statistically significant. These findings led to a voluntary withdrawal in the third line indication by the company. Unfortunately for them, a somewhat desperate filing as a first-line therapy also didn't work out. If you watched my previous video, you would remember that pharmaceutical companies burn a lot of money on development and operations. Clovis Oncology tried to cut costs through layoffs and raise additional money, but ultimately had to throw in the towel and file for bankruptcy. In summary, PFS benefit does not necessarily translate into true survival benefit, which is most important. Also, we saw that the FDA and EMA can reach different scientific conclusions looking at the same data. Finally, it's chemistry time. Here we have 2 things to check out. First, we will look at just one part of Rucaparib's original large-scale process route, and second, go through a more efficient synthesis in full. The process route, albeit long, has an interesting reaction early on. It starts with a nitration of this benzoic acid, which selectively nitrates meta to the acid. So far, nothing special. Most of you should know this selectivity. Doing a nitration with 23 liters of concentrated nitric acid is nothing to sneeze at, but we are more eager to see what happens after this step and a simple esterification. What follows is a Leimgruber-Batcho indole synthesis, which leverages the moderate acidity at the benzylic position of these nitroarenes. In the first step, the benzyl anion is formed and attacks the reagent, dimethylformamide dimethylacetal. This adds 1 carbon to the system and after spontaneous elimination of methanol, a conjugated link is introduced. The second step of this indole synthesis is the reduction of the nitro group. The liberated nucleophilic aniline can intramolecularly cyclize with the iminium and again eliminate dimethylamine to create the aromatic indole. Although you might expect that immediate intramolecular attack in a 5-endo-trig fashion would go through an anion that is very much stabilized through the ester group on the ring, I think that is kinetically disfavored due to Baldwin's rules. The remaining steps are not revolutionary, so we will instead look at the very direct synthesis published in 2022. It's a little bit of a cheated start as the starting material is already highly functionalized, but you can buy this commercially, so it's fair game. The first step is a Hec reaction with the highly reactive aryl iodide. Next, the aryl amine was condensed with an aldehyde bearing the other half of Rucaparib. At this point, we essentially have already all the atoms that we need. It's just about linking them and getting to the right oxidation states. To create the indole, the chemist used a cyanide-catalyzed imino-Stetter reaction. You might remember this one as a prime example of Umpolung chemistry. The mechanism starts with a nucleophilic addition of cyanide to the aldamine. The negative charge first sits on nitrogen, but rapidly swaps alpha to the nitrile. Now we have the typical Stetter 1,4 conjugate addition onto the vinyl nitrile. Finally, just like we've seen in the previous Leimgruber-Batcho synthesis, elimination delivers the aromatic indole system. This regenerates the catalytic cyanide, which is why the reaction works with just 20 mole percent of sodium cyanide. Well, what do we do next with the nitrile? You've guessed it, we need to reduce it to the amine and link it to the ester. Because typical hydrogenation did not result in any reaction, the authors looked for other reducing agents. Interestingly, the generation of nickel boride from nickel chloride and sodium borohydride worked smoothly and chemoselectively, leaving the ester group in peace. The lactamization occurred spontaneously under these conditions, so this was quite convenient as well. The ultimate step was a simple deprotection of the amine sitting at the other side of the molecule, completing the total 5-step synthesis. That's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed the statistics, history and chemistry. If you liked it, please subscribe and activate notifications to stay tuned for future videos. I would also like to thank all the channel members for supporting my work. As always, I will catch you in the next one.